Hi, my name is Dr. Russell T. Warne, and I'm an associate professor of psychology at Utah Valley University. I'm the author of a new article published in Gifted Child Quarterly entitled An Evaluation and Vindication of Lewis Terman, What the Father of Gifted Education Can Teach the 21st Century. This article is my assessment of the work and legacy of Lewis Terman, a leading psychologist who is best known as the creator of the Stanford Binet Intelligence Scales and who laid the foundation for the scholarly field of gifted education. Despite Terman's important contributions, sometimes his work stirs controversy today. Because of comments in some of his widely read works published in the 1910s and 20s, some people criticize him for overemphasizing IQ, supporting meritocracies, and having a blind devotion to nature over nurture. In the article, I use Terman's own writing to show that most of these criticisms have a foundation in reality, but are oversimplified. For example, Terman recognized that IQ scores did not tell psychologists everything about a child's mental performance and that they were poor at predicting specific life outcomes. And while he believed that genetics had a stronger influence than environment, he did not deny the importance of environmental influences on development. A criticism that I think deserves more attention is Terman's tendency to form an opinion about a scientific issue without strong enough data to support his confidence. I believe his opinions about the influence of genetics on intelligence were not fully supported for much of his career. Terman also drew conclusions about how children with different IQ scores would be suitable for different careers, even though he did not have data at the time to observe how childhood IQ correlated with employment outcomes in adulthood. It is also important to mention Terman's famous longitudinal study, the Genetic Studies of Genius. The study began in 1921 and followed over 1,500 children with IQ scores of 135 or higher until 1999. It's an impressive study, but it is often misunderstood. For example, some people criticize the sample for being almost entirely white and disproportionately middle class. Critics say that the largely positive life outcomes for the sample members were no more common than what would be expected from any sample with a similar social background. I show in the article that this is not true. The sample was also disproportionately male, but I also show how accusations of sex bias in Terman's sampling procedure are not justified. Terman's career has lessons to teach modern professionals in education and psychology. One lesson is his willingness to change his mind as new data emerged. Many condemnations of Terman are based on his writings from the 1910s and 1920s, but he lived until 1956, and in the last 25 years of his life, he changed his mind about many professional issues, which is what good scientists do when they realize they are wrong. Terman was also a master at description, and his detailed accounts of bright children contain interesting information that is still useful today. I also like his trial and error approach to solving a thorny educational or scientific problem, and many scientists would benefit from his spirit of inventiveness. This video is just a quick survey of the article. The article contains a lot of details and analysis that show that a simple judgment of Terman does not fit the data. Like many historical figures, he is complex, and I hope you find the article useful in helping you understand this important figure in the history of psychology.